Hello? Hello? Can you hear that? Hello? Hello? Friends, if you'd like to come in and grab a seat, we're going to start in 41 seconds. If you've been here for a while, you would have seen the countdown timers restart about 15 times. We tried to figure out the live stream. It's going now. This is the actual countdown, so we'll start in a moment. Welcome. Good evening, everyone. It is wonderful to see so many people here tonight. I know there's lots more tuning in via the live stream as well. And I don't know about you, but it's such an encouragement to see how God is already at work raising up a vast partnership network for Tim and Sam as they prepare to undertake their ministry apprenticeships over the next 2 years. But tonight, we're people gathering from all different places, and so just to quickly bring everyone up to speed, if we haven't met, my name's Michael. I'm one of the ministers here at Engadine and Heathcote Anglican, and this is the church where Tim and Sam have been members for a very long time. They're both active and loved and respected members of Night Church and all the different ministries that they're involved in. Next year, Tim's going to be undertaking a ministry apprenticeship, what we call MTS, here with us, and Sam is heading down to Canberra to do hers. And so tonight we're going to hear from both of them, and even Liv as well, Tim's wife, about how they got to where they are, their fears and expectations as they look ahead, and how we can be partnering together with them. But before we hear from them though, I just wanted to take a bit of time to share with you a little bit more about MTS. And to do that, I just want to read three short passages from the Bible as we go. And the first one is from Matthew chapter 28, right at the end of Matthew 28. And the context of this passage is that Jesus has just risen from the dead. He is God's king forever. But before he returns to heaven to rule from his throne, he gathers his little bunch of disciples together. And this is what he says to them. He says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Now, it's been almost 2,000 years since Jesus gave that command to his disciples. But indeed, that's what they went and did. They went and made disciples, who made more disciples, all across the globe. I mean, we are here tonight, aren't we? The result of their ministry. And it's happened because Jesus has been at work through all those who follow him, each and every one of his disciples. Through each and every one of his disciples, Jesus is taking the gospel to the ends of the earth, and he is achieving that mission through each and every person who follows him. So firstly, as we think about MTS tonight, proclaiming Jesus is not just a job for some. MTS is not about us sitting back and watching Tim and Sam do their thing over the next 2 years. Rather, MTS is actually an opportunity for all of us to partner together as one in the gospel with Tim and Sam as we join together in the mission of Jesus. So that together the gospel of Jesus might be proclaimed ever more clearly to the ends of the earth. There are still so many people who need to hear about Jesus. The good news that calls people to come and follow him so that they can be saved from their sin and the judgment of God, so that they might have eternal life, and to proclaim him because he is the one who is able to transform us into his image, his likeness, so that God might be glorified. So firstly, an MTS apprenticeship is a partnership in the gospel. Secondly, MTS is about entrusting men and women with the task of teaching the gospel to others. So let me read from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, which if you like cricket and you're old enough to remember him, is the Richie Beno verse of the Bible. 2 for 22. The Apostle Paul writes to Timothy, and he says this, "The things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust it to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. Now, a little bit of context about this verse. Jesus has entrusted Paul to be one of his apostles. So an apostle was someone who spoke with the authority of the king himself. And so it was through the apostles, people like Paul, that Jesus revealed his word to us. That is, the apostles spoke God's word, and that's what we now have recorded for us in the Bible. Now, Timothy, who Paul was writing this letter to, this verse to, he was not an apostle. In many ways, Timothy was kind of like Paul's MTS apprenticeship. Paul had been training Timothy for ministry, and Paul had entrusted Timothy with teaching God's word. But what Paul is now saying to Timothy is this. He's saying, the message of God that I taught you, well, you are now to go and entrust that message to reliable people who also, like you, Timothy, will be able to be going and entrusting that message to even more reliable people, and on the chain goes. MTS stands for the Ministry Training Strategy. And it's one of the ways that we want to take responsibility for raising up, training and equipping the next generation of mature Christian men and women who will be able to guard the gospel, defend the gospel, teach the gospel, live out the gospel. Men and women who in turn will entrust the truth of God's word to the next generation and equip them to pass it on to the next as together we take the gospel to the ends of the earth. So that's the second verse. The third one is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16. And again, Paul is writing to his apprentice, Timothy, and he says to Timothy, this is what matters most. This is what you need to know about ministry more than anything else. He says, watch your life and your doctrine closely. Your life and doctrine, watch them closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. And when it comes to leadership, our culture prioritizes leaders who have charisma and ability and popularity. And it would be very tempting for me as Tim's trainer next year and Sam with her trainer to pump them full of skills because we think that's the most important thing that they could ever need for a lifetime of full-time gospel ministry and help them figure out how to be popular and grow their Instagram following and all that kind of stuff, which I wouldn't be able to help you with. But anyway. Now, there is a need to learn all kinds of skills in ministry, but isn't it striking that Paul doesn't even mention that kind of thing here? He just says to Timothy, watch your life and your doctrine closely. Your doctrine, your knowledge of God through his word in the Bible, because if you're going to teach the gospel to others, well, you need to know how to handle God's word correctly. And your life, because if you are leading God's people, and calling others to follow Jesus, then you are the model of what it looks like to be a faithful disciple, and your life displays to the world the goodness of the gospel that you preach. So friends, over the next 2 years, Tim and Sam's training is going to revolve around their own growth as disciples of Jesus. So their personal Bible reading, their prayer life, their godliness, because those are the foundations that will best enable them to use the many skills that they're going to pick up and learn along the way. MTS is an apprenticeship. It's 2 years of on-the-job training, and it's designed to help Tim and Sam figure out how God has wired them as people and to ask the big questions, you know, am I the right person for paid gospel ministry? Do I have the desire and the drive? Am I prepared to serve others like Jesus? Am I ready to commit to this for the long term? They're going to be thinking about all these things. They've got a lot to figure out. But it's going to be in partnership with each one of us. Together, we want to encourage, support, and equip them to be people who we can entrust the gospel to. And we'll do that by helping and praying for them to grow in their own life and doctrine. That's what we're going to be doing the next 2 years. And we're going to hear tonight a bit more from Sam and from Tim and Liv as well down the back. If you guys want to come up, heard enough from me, need to hear from you guys. We'll just rearrange things up the front. I'm going to sit on that one so you guys can use these microphones to work out how to do COVID-safe interviews today on a live stream. I think we've figured it out. You got that one, Sam? You guys can share the one at the back. I'll go down here. Let Ben work out the camera. Alrighty. So we're going to hear some few different things from these guys. Who wants to go first? Tim's going first. Hurry up and turn your iPad on, Tim, so you can get all the answers. You're good? Excellent. Tim, do you want to tell us a little bit? How did you get to this point where you're sitting up on a stage being interviewed about doing MTS? You should have gone first, Sam. Tim's all over the shop. You ready, mate? You good now? Yeah. No, we're not good. We've got to turn it on, Warren. Yours working, Tim? Oh, there we go. That was something. Yeah. I don't know. Is that working? All right, Sam, you're up.
Okay.
How did you get to this point, Sam, where you're sitting on a stage with Tim making a fool of himself?
Yeah, it would have started when I first understood and accepted the gospel for myself. So that was here in Gideon's, probably around year 9, year 10. I had the opportunity to be part of Bible study and youth group where faithful leaders opened up the Bible with me and taught me how to read it and understand it and see who Jesus is and what he's done and how, yeah, the only way to be saved and made into a right relationship with him is through trusting in Jesus. And I was really excited to have leaders who were there to encourage me and peers as well. So grew a lot in that time. But I think for me, in thinking about that, I was very much sort of selfish in my understanding of going to youth group and going to church because I just wanted to learn lots and I wanted to be encouraged myself. I didn't quite understand that being Christian was about serving others. So then once I finished high school, I did Year 13, which is a Christian gap year program with YouthWorks. And there I was really stretched outside my comfort zone as a Christian and meeting lots of new people and digging deeper into God's word. And I had the opportunity to serve more here at church. And that grew me a lot in thinking about, ministry in serving others. It taught me that ministry isn't always easy. Sometimes things don't go to plan and it can be difficult. But it's also a real joy to see people come to know Christ and to rightly respond to him. Also, while I was doing Year 13, had the opportunity to go to Fiji to do mission. And so that really broadened my eyes beyond God's plan just for here in Engadine or in the Shire, but actually seeing people from all nations coming to know and trust in him. And the other thing that Year 13 did was encourage me to get involved in the AFES group at Wollongong Uni. So AFES is Australian Fellowship of Evangelical Students, and I'll explain a little bit more later on about that. But basically the Christian group at Wollongong Uni. And while I was there, I was really challenged in how to read God's word and how it was to shape all of my life, because it's through the Bible that God speaks, that he saves and transforms people in Christ. So I got the opportunity to read the Bible one-to-one with Jeanette Chin, who will be my trainer down at ANU, alongside training in different areas of theology and conferences, which taught me to test everything that I learned against God's word and the importance of equipping others to also do the same. And so the staff, in particular Jeanette, really encouraged me not just to be discipled myself, but to think through how I could disciple others. So I had the opportunity to try reading the Bible one-to-one with some other girls and co-leading Bible studies. It was a real great joy to see God work through my weakness in those areas. And also while I was at the uni, I had the opportunity to go to a number of conferences, so like Mission Minder Conference with people here from church and at uni. And that really challenged me to think through how Jesus was to impact all different areas of my life. And to think through what that would look like sacrificially. These conferences also had the opportunity to talk with people like Dodzie and like Jeanette about the possibility of doing MTS, to think about being trained and equipped to serve Christ long term, whether that's in full-time ministry or other contexts. And I think through those conferences was really a challenge to think about why I maybe didn't want to consider ministry or didn't want to consider MTS. And I think those reasons were very much out of selfishness of not wanting to leave comforts of life and sort of life that in church that I knew. But these conferences really helped me to look back to the cross and to see how Christ has so sacrificially served us and the encouragement to sacrificially serve others as well. And I think kind of the final thing that sort of encouraged me to think about doing MTS was going overseas last year. So I did a semester abroad in Hong Kong, and I was really confronted there by the urgency of sharing Christ and teaching others to read and understand God's word. So while I was there, I was exposed to some student groups and churches that didn't quite have God's word as the final authority or didn't understand how the Bible was all about Jesus. And I think I was convicted that if I believe that Jesus is coming back soon and that the only way to be saved is by trusting in him, then I knew that some of these people who didn't understand who Jesus was, they wouldn't be standing with Christ on that last day. And so I was challenged to think about why wouldn't I want to be equipped to not only teach others about God's word, but also teach them how to then teach others as well.
Thanks. Tim, do you want to share, how did you get to this point? Still not working. No luck. Do you want to run the... hey, Andy, can you go to Warren and get the handheld microphone for me? We'll try that one. See if it's got batteries in it. Probably haven't used it for 6 months. Otherwise, the live stream people won't be able to hear us. Does it work, Andy? Do you want to be the tester? No?
All right. Hello?
No?
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Cool.
Welcome, Tim. Good to have you join us tonight.
Good to be here.
Excellent. How did we get to this point, Tim?
Cool. Yeah, so similar to Sam, God's blessed me by putting a loving family around me that loved God and really wanted me to see his love for me, Jesus' sacrifice that he made for my life. And he put lots of other key people around me that supported me in my relationship with God and, really showed me, God's love for me and how his message isn't just for the people in Engadine, but it's for everyone around me, for kids, for adults, for, people that are much older than me. How do I say that politely? Really importantly in that there were the really great guys that were investing in me and mentoring me, like Matt Richards, Steve-O, my youth leader, Dodsy, plenty of others. They always challenged me and demonstrate how they were using their lives to serve God and how sacrificial they were in their lives to see God's kingdom grow and to see people come to know God's love. And I think throughout my life, I've been convicted to have serving God's kingdom as a priority because Jesus literally gave up his perfect life for me. So I want to use my life, which is flawed, to bring him glory and show other people his love, that he saved me, even though I didn't deserve it. And through serving in different ministries, I've just seen God's work and his amazing grace spread throughout Engadine, in Toowoomba Bay, different ministries I've been involved in, and how incredible gospel work is and how important that is. And it just an awesome love for it. I want to be a part of that. I see that is the most important work that we can do here with our time on earth until Jesus comes. And I think it was 4 years ago or about that Dodsy first brought up the idea of MTS. And asked me to be considering that in the future. And since then, it's been a long time of thinking about it, praying about it, plenty of chats with Dodsy and Christina at their house over dinner, and heaps of people around me, including those mentors I mentioned earlier, tapping me on the shoulder and suggesting, do I want to go into ministry, or how are you using your life to serve Jesus sacrificially, not just when it's convenient, but actually going out of my way to serve him. And since over the last few years, I think lots of things have gotten in the way, or sort of put ministry on the back burner. Like, I graduated uni, we got married, it takes up a lot of Liv's a great wife. I got a full-time job. just things that take up time and energy and a lot more mind space than I had to think about when I was at home and at uni, just took away from being able to serve in different ministries, being able to invest in people around me, and sort of became a lot more, all right, how am I planning for the next week, the next year in my life? How am I setting myself up for the future? I think being convicted that no, that's the thing that we should be looking forward to is much greater, God's kingdom that's going to be everlasting. And things that really helped me think through that and my thought process were, like Sam mentioned earlier, the Mission Minded Conference. It helped me to think about not just MTS, but actually how I'm using my life to serve Jesus, as I talked about. And it was good because we got to talk to different people in different life stages, similar life stages. What it looks like to be serving God with your whole life, whether that's secular work or in ministry. How am I using my life best for his service? I guess a lot of what we were thinking about there was reasons for doing MTS, but also reasons not doing MTS. And I think we found that they were mostly around our comfort, our security, whether we can get a deposit on a house in a few years, holidays, dual income, like that sort of stuff. But God's blessed us with that we're able to live in Sydney and Ingerdeen and have really cool jobs. But God's given us blessings so that we can grow his kingdom. And some of those ways is to make sacrifices of those blessings he's given us, to give those up for his kingdom and sort of take up our cross and follow him, I think. And yeah, I think something that really hit home at a conference was a guy saying, if you were guaranteed 80 to 100 grand a year, what would you do? Would you keep working or quit my job? I sort of thought, oh, nah, probably quit my job. He asked, all right, what would you do with your time then? It's like, oh, probably want to go and be trained and serve in church because I can do that and I've been freed up. And he's like, well, that's what people are offering to do by asking you to be trained on MTS. And I was like, oh, okay, I guess we've got an answer there. But yeah. But yeah, I think lately how we got to this point, lots of thinking, lots of going back and forth of, yes, I want to do it, no, I don't, is God's convicted us of that we're to take up our cross, we're to make sacrifices, we're to be uncomfortable for him, we're here to live for his kingdom, not for our kingdom, not just for the life Liv and I can build. It's about God's family. And we realised that the reasons for not doing MTS seemed a bit selfish, things that we didn't need. We didn't need to have all those savings behind us. We needed to be serving God and giving things up for his kingdom to grow. And I think by doing MTS, we can be freed up to serve God more humbly and sacrificially and faithfully. And it can be a good way that we can use gifts or learn skills to be serving God and be growing in him and his relationship. And yeah, hopefully to be encouraging others as well. But yeah.
Fantastic. Sam, do you want to share what are you excited about for next year? What are you looking forward to?
Lots of different things. I think one of the things that I'm really excited about is having more time to be able to open up the Bible with people. It's one of the things that I really loved about being involved in the Christian group at uni was getting to do that, and this year as well. There's always a struggle when you're trying to work around, you know, uni classes or around work. So I'm excited to be able to, have more time to do that and also to be trained in how to do that well. I'm really keen to get back involved in uni ministry and the exciting opportunities that brings. Uni is a really cool mission field where people are coming from all over and they're at a point in their life where they're making decisions about their future, they have more independence, they're encouraged to think through what they're learning and to make decisions. And so, a really great opportunity to share the good news that Jesus is Lord and why his kingdom is worth living for. Particularly at ANU, a lot of the students there are from all over Australia and all over the world, so a great opportunity for them to then take the gospel with them as they go back into the workplace or wherever they end up. I think personally I'm really keen to be stretched and challenged in my own personal godliness and in thinking through ministry and working out, what my strengths and weaknesses are, and alongside the staff and other MTSs, whether I would be well suited to do full-time ministry paid in the future. Getting to work that out alongside other people who are at that same stage as well. So, it's a different thing.
Yeah. Tim and Liv, what are you guys looking forward to? Are you excited for?
Cool. Big thing is we're super excited that the church has an awesome heart for discipleship and they're generous and generous enough to free people up to go to be trained to serve God and to take up ministry apprenticeships. I'm excited to be a part of more ministries, of the many ministries we do here at Engadine. I've sort of had to step back from a few ministries since taking up full-time work, and I've sort of felt, oh, I don't get to do gospel work, this awesome stuff of seeing people come to know Jesus or grow in their faith. So I'm really keen to get back in there and get alongside people and tell people of the awesome news of Jesus. Yeah, I'm really excited to get alongside people and make new relationships, invest in old ones, people that I haven't had to gotten to interact with, it, like people at the morning services. Yeah, I'm encouraged to learn off them and be pushed by them, and hopefully I get to do the same for them. Yeah, and I'll grow in making relationships. Like, I work in science. It's not exactly the most people-oriented thing ever. I'm excited to grow in that. Yeah.
I think a couple of other things that we are also excited about is kind of seeing how God will both challenge both of us and grow and stretch us in our knowledge and love and understanding for Him, and I guess also in the ways that we both serve. And just working that out, I guess. Obviously, Tim's the one doing MTS, but we've both made this decision to kind of partner together, which is also a really exciting thing. We're also really keen to see how God continues to work over the next 2 years in our church, and I think more than just, I guess, the services that we attend, but it'll be exciting to also go along to other services or be a part of other ministries and things. So, yeah, just really excited to see how God will work over the next couple of years. And just, I guess, kind of what Sam said as well, what might be in store for the future, whether that will be full-time ministry or not. So, yeah, just seeing what's in store.
Fantastic. Sam, what are you fearing or dreading or unsure about?
So, obviously, moving is a big deal, going down to a new place, a new church, getting to know new people, new relationships. So, a lot of uncertainty can be a bit scary. Also exciting, but, yeah, kind of the unknown can be a little bit fearful. But it's been encouraging going through the book of Daniel this term, being reminded that God is very much in control in uncertainty, that He is good and He is faithful and He works for His glory. So, I can, trust Him in these uncertainties. I guess other fears are probably personal weakness of, I don't know enough, or I'm not wise enough, why am I doing this? But I think, in a sense, it's not, those fears are looking to myself or looking to my capabilities. As encouraged, I've been reading through 2 Corinthians, and Paul is talking to the Corinthians, and some of them have kind of stopped following Paul and are following these sort of super apostles. I think they're really impressive, and Paul's sort of talking to them and saying, hey, I didn't come to be impressive, I didn't come for you to look at me, but I came to point you to the one who is impressive, to point you to Christ. So I think that's encouragement to, not look into my own abilities, but I think those fears will definitely still creep in at times as well. I think not so much a fear, but I think the rightful pressure of leading others in Christ and that responsibility is something that's quite weighty as well.
Tim, Liv? You can go first, Liv.
I think just for us, one of the big things is just trying to work out, or I guess it's not really known exactly what it'll look like or how it will look in kind of our day to day. And I think for us over the past few years, obviously marriage was a big thing.
For Tim, it was, apparently.
Lots of time. but like, there's been a couple of other big kind of changes, and we've just kind of gotten into a comfortable routine at the moment. So I think, it's a little bit learning, I guess, what will be, but I don't know, still excited for it. And in some ways, it kind of feels like it's a little bit of jumping into that unknown, but we really do know and trust that God has everything under control and is sovereign. And so, much excited too.
Yeah, and I think we're both pretty introverted people, so I guess just how that works, like ministry is all around people and making those relationships, so how we work out, how we support each other in going and serving our church. Big thing for me is having more responsibility is scary. I'm being trained up serving the church, but there is a sense that you get a bit more responsibility, and I want to be faithful and humble in how I do that. So I'm a bit, it's just a bit daunting of having that extra bit. But yeah.
I don't know if that's well phrased, but yeah. All right, so we've heard a little bit about how you got here, what you're looking forward to. Sam, what are you actually going to be doing next year down in Canberra? What is AFES and
all the acronyms? So yeah, I'll be working with AFES. So AFES, as I mentioned before, is the Australian Fellowship of Evangelical Students. So they're a fellowship, so a group of people who seek to prayerfully proclaim Jesus Christ at university to present everyone mature in Him. So that's from Colossians 1:28, and so they seek to do that by building student groups that evangelize, encourage, train, and send. So yeah, evangelizing, sharing Jesus with the students on campus, encouraging and training people in God's word, and then sending them out to wherever they end up. So I'll be doing that at ANU, which is the Australian National University in Canberra. So a little bit about ANU, I don't know heaps, but basically it was established back in 1946 by the Australian government with the aim to kind of stand against some of the greatest universities in the world. They have about 26,000 students, half of them are postgraduate, a third are international students, and it's about 24% are living on campus, which means that a lot of people are coming who aren't from Canberra, which is an exciting opportunity. So the AFES group at ANU is called FOCUS, which stands for Fellowship of Christian University Students. So that's the group of students that come together to read the Bible, to be trained by God's word, and to grow in relationship with God. So that's kind of the group that I'll be a part of, what I'll be actually doing there. I'll be reading the Bible with other female students, be running or co-leading Bible study groups, preparing for camps and conferences that happen through the group, different evangelistic events or walk-up or mission weeks, alongside meeting with my trainer, with the other AFES staff and MTSs.
Exciting.
Yeah.
Tim, what do you think you're doing?
I think, subject to change apparently. So Dodsey will be my trainer, so I'll be following him around, being trained with him, meeting up with him and thinking through how we serve the church and how we do things here. But specific things I'll be doing in the church, I'll be at the night service here at Ingadine, and I'll be gradually taking over from the Kennedys, who think through how we do our gatherings at night, why we do things, why we do church in a certain way, how can we improve things to make people, just see God, and I don't know, what's the word we use? I can't remember.
Yeah, we'll train you in all that.
Yeah, that's right. I'll get all the buzzwords. Yeah,
all the buzzwords. That's
yeah.
Right.
So I'm looking forward to that. That'll be really cool because that's where we attend, and being more involved in that excites me. I'll also be going to the 9 a.m. service at Ingadine, being involved with that. Just seeing how that runs, getting to know the people there, forming relationships there. We lead a growth group on Tuesday night, so we'll be continuing doing that, which is exciting, getting alongside those guys who've, really formed a good community in that this year. I'll be leading, running scripture as well, which I haven't done before, so see a scripture class, so we'll see how that goes. always good. I'll be, investing in a few guys at Ingadine, some young men as well, reading the Bible with them, just doing life with them, seeing what each other are struggling with, how we can encourage each other and build each other up towards God. And I think different things. I think I'll throw in a bit of preaching, I think you said as well, different stuff. Whatever I'm allowed to do.
There'll be lots of things, mate. We'll keep you very busy. It's a long list already. You both got lots on next year. It's really exciting. Lots and lots of varied and different opportunities. Sam, MTS is 2 years. What are you hoping to get out of your 2 years of MTS?
Yeah. God willing, hoping to see many students come to know and grow in Christ down at ANU. Hoping to have a greater understanding of my own strengths and weaknesses in ministry, to grow in my love and knowledge of God's word, and being trained in how to read and understand it faithfully and help others to do the same, and work out with my trainer and with the other staff how I might be able to serve God long term, whether that is in going to Bible college and then doing full-time paid ministry, or whether it's going back to secular work, seeking to think through well with them what that might look like long term.
Tim, Liv, what are you guys hoping to achieve?
I think a big part of it is ultimately seeing and seriously considering whether full-time pay or paid ministry is the way that we can serve God with our lives. And so, I think this will be an awesome opportunity to get more of that. See what it's like, really. And I think we're also hoping to get more of an idea of how we can both serve God together and separately and how that kind of works. And I think I'm continuing to encourage each other in that.
I think making relationships and getting more used to doing relational ministry, one-to-ones, meeting up with people. Because I think it's easy to fall into the trap of just doing the formal ministries, like I run my growth group, I do kids' church, and that's my ministry, that's how I serve God. But actually, no, it's getting alongside people and doing life with them. Just seeing how we do that and doing that well, growing in that, because that's a growing point for me. And along with that, how God's going to convict and grow me and how I serve him with my whole life, whether that's in paid ministry or secular work.
Hmm. Fantastic. Well, friends, we're going to spend a little bit of time praying for Tim and Sam now. And so I'm going to get Matt, are you praying for Tim? That's right. And Brioni's praying for Sam. So if you guys want to come on up, we'll get out of the way. We'll get our COVID-safe lectern back up for you guys. And then we'll share a little bit about how you can actually partner with these guys. Who wants to go first? Standoff. You're up, Matt. See if your microphone works. Didn't work for Tim.
Okay. Let's pray. Hands in pockets. Dear God, thank you so much for your gospel. Thank you that you have the message of eternal life. And we thank you that this message has come to us in a small town of Ingadine thousands of years later. Lord, we thank you for your saving message. And we thank you for the heart of the gospel. And we thank you for Jesus. Lord, we thank you at this time for Tim and for Liv. And we thank you that you have worked in them in such a way that they've sacrificed, a new full-time job that he absolutely loves. For the sake of the gospel. We thank you that you've been working through him for years, Lord, for decades, with the family that he's grown up in, the church that you've raised him in, and through your spirit and through your word as you continue to grow in him. Lord, we thank you for Liv being a supportive wife, a wife who challenges, a wife who loves, and a wife who listens. And we thank you for their partnership, and for their decision, their prayerful decision to go into this training for 2 years to decide whether full-time paid ministry is for them. Lord, we pray for their marriage, this time for yet another big change in their life. Lord, we pray that you will strengthen their marriage through this. Lord, you will help them through unsettling times. You will help them to continue to depend on you and listen well to each other. Lord, I pray as next year gets busy and different, help them to firstly prioritise themselves as their ministry. I pray that Tim will be a great leading husband and he will love and lead live well. And I pray that Liv will be a great listening wife who looks after her husband. Lord, we pray for next year as they work out the logistics, how it would all work. I pray you'll protect them through that. Lord, we pray for the next 2 years. We pray that it will be Christ-centered. Lord, we pray for growth. Lord, we pray growth in relationships in particular, Lord. Help Tim continue to find people to read the Bible with, find people to nurture and to disciple. Lord, we pray as him and Liv move to 9 a.m. church, help them to find great community there who love them and who support them. But Lord, I pray that they'll be able to lead them well as well. Lord, we pray that next year will be informative as well, especially in deciding their future for full-time ministry. Help them to be coming into this experience with open hearts and open minds, Lord. Ready to grow, ready to change, ready to spend 2 years solely devoted in preaching your word and to grow. Lord, we pray that Tim will trust you for all things. Lord, it's so easy to depend on you, to depend on ourselves and our own strength, but I pray that Tim will completely depend on you. Lord, in the good times and the bad, help him to remember that you are there and you are holding his hand the whole way through. Lord, we pray and thank you for Tim's humility. But Lord, we pray as he continue to get more responsibility, help him to remain humble and a faithful servant of Christ. Help him to be a great servant who learns to lead and not a great leader who learns to serve. Lord, I pray that he will be a servant man, a godly man. Lord, we pray for our church, finally. We pray that we'll be a sending church, a church that is prayerful all the time for Tim and Liv, a church that is continues to seek and send others, and a church that is sacrificial in their giving to those who get sent out. Lord, we pray all this in your name. Amen.
Alrighty, continue praying with me. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we humbly thank you for all your gifts so freely given, for life and health and safety, for work and rest and friendship, for the wonder of your creation. Above all, we praise you for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, for his death and resurrection, and for your life-giving spirit and the hope of sharing in your glory. Lord God, we rejoice in your greatness and your power, your gentleness and your love, your justice and your mercy. Tonight, as we gather, we thank you and praise you for Sam. Thank you for her kindness, generosity, humility, gentleness, and love. Thank you for the way in which you have used her at Engadine and Heathcote, Idaho and Hong Kong. Thank you for the gifts you have given that she has been able to use in kids ministry, youth ministry, camps, beach missions, and at UOW. Thank you for Bruce and Leanne and the family and those around Sam that have constantly pointed her towards you always. We thank you, Father, for saving her and challenging her to continue thinking about what it looks like to be a sacrificial servant. Enable her by your Spirit to honour you in her thoughts and serve you in her life always. As Sam begins the preparations of moving and finding new accommodation, we ask that you allow this to be a smooth process. As she joins a new church, family, and begins to build new relationships, we pray for excitement, for humility, and for patience. As she adjusts to life in Canberra, we ask that she would continue standing firm, knowing that you are always by her side. We pray that she would trust you always and know that you have her plans prepared and that you will provide all that she needs. Father, we pray for Richard and Jeanette Chin as they are joined by Kevin and Mathia, along with Sam and other members of this ministry. We pray you would continue spurring them on in love. Despite the many changes of staff in recent years, we pray that the staff and students will adjust well, especially as they continue to navigate university ministry in the present pandemic. We pray that they would work well together as a team and all for your glory. We pray for uni ministry as a whole in Australia, as many have adapted to online ministry and slowly back to face-to-face. We ask for strength and renewed energy for all involved. We pray that many students continue to be encouraged to stand firm in your promises and love. And we boldly ask that many more will come to know you as their one true and living God. As Sam begins ministry at ANU, we ask that you would give her wisdom and boldness to faithfully point students to Christ and never to be tempted to rely on her own strengths. In humility, we ask that you would expose the weaknesses so that she can rest on you all the more. We ask that you will keep her rooted and built up in your gospel. As she begins this two-year journey, grow her to be more and more like Christ. Father, grant her wisdom as she continues to think and pray through what it might look like to serve you in the future. We pray that you would be with her and her family as they support her during this time. Help them to all stand firm, knowing that you have her plans in place. Father, we thank you for your perfect will. May it be done in our lives as we continue to seek you. In your almighty name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, guys. If everyone wants to take out their piece of paper that they got on their seats on the way in, if you're watching on the live stream, you obviously don't have bits of paper. I'll tell you how to do all this in a moment. But there's one for Tim and one for Sam, obviously. You can work out which one's which. On the back of both of them, There's a chance for you to fill out your details, to let them know that you'd like to be a partner with them. But as we come to fill these out, it's just worth reflecting for a moment, just quickly, that as we come to read the Bible, one of the things we keep seeing over and again is that ministry happens in partnership. It's not something that individuals do. So we see it in the Old Testament, we see it in the way that Paul raises up support amongst all the churches as they partner together in the task of taking Christ to the ends of the earth. And so we want to make sure that we keep partnering together with Tim and Sam as they prepare to do MTS. Now there's different ways that we can do that. One way we can do it is by praying for them. And if you'd like to be receiving regular prayer updates from them, you can tick that box on the form. I should say, lots of people won't have pens tonight because it's not COVID safe. There's a QR code on your thing, and if you scan the QR code, there's one for Tim and one for Sam, it'll take you to a Google form where you can just fill all this out and you can just take your piece of paper home. All the same stuff's on there. If you're watching online, if you're on our the Engadine Church website, just straight below the video, there's a button for Tim and a button for Sam. You can click on that, it'll take you to the form. If you're watching on YouTube, just go down below the video and there's links there as well in the description about the video. One of the ways we can pray, partner with them is to pray for them. And so as ministry happens, God has gifted us in lots and lots of different ways, and we all serve in the kingdom in lots of different ways. As Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, some people plant and some people water, but he says it's God who gives the growth. So we need to be praying for Tim and Sam and their ministry over the next 2 years and beyond. So if you'd like regular updates, you can tick that box. But we can also be supporting them financially. So Sam and Tim are both looking to raise a little bit over $36,000 next year. And that'll free them up from having to work full-time. It'll go to things like their super and to registration and all that kind of stuff, which is a fair bit of money for them to raise. And so we need to be able to partner together to help them to raise that money. You might like to consider giving financially with the money that God has given to you. God has given us all things, I think as Tim mentioned earlier, to use for his kingdom. And there's lots and lots of ways we do that and need to do that with our money. But tonight we want to ask whether you might be able to prayerfully consider giving to Sam and Tim. And the work that they're going to be doing. And there's two ways you might like to do that. You might like to give a one-off donation, and there's a box you can tick for that and indicate how much you're planning to give just to help them to be able to plan what they're going to do and how they can keep fundraising. But there's a second box there as well, which I think I want to encourage you to consider, and that is to give regularly and to be in the habit of giving regularly to their ministry. And so you can tick that one as well, and then you can set up in your bank account or somewhere like that once a month transaction for them. That's all on the form. If you've got questions about that, you can come and ask me. I think Sam was telling me she needs to raise 80% of her partnership financial support before she can begin being on campus in Canberra next year. So do keep considering that, and as situations change over the next 2 years, you might like to keep reconsidering that as well. But for all of us, we can be praying that God will provide what is needed. The other way you can be partnering with them isn't on there, and that is just to talk to them and to keep in touch, to ask them how it's going. I think particularly for Sam, as she moves cities and settles in and needs to create new relationships and new friends, she's going to be part of a very supportive staff team down there, but it's moving cities and starting afresh. So do keep in touch with Sam. You can keep in touch with Tim too if you like, but he'll be a bit easier to see. But talk to them, ask them, how's it going? What can I be praying for you? What are you learning? What are you struggling with? Share life with them. That's how we can be partnering together. So if you want to fill out a paper form, that's fine. You can give it to me, or if you come to this church, you can drop it in the giving box over the next few weeks. But the simplest way to do it is just open up your phone, turn on the camera, scan that QR code, and that'll take you to where you need to go, and you just fill it out. It'll take you 30 seconds. If you've got any questions, that kind of brings us to the end of the night. If you want to come and ask Sam and Tim and Liv questions, do come and do that. Obviously, need to remind you, make sure we keep our social distancing with each other, the 1.5 metres. But you're welcome to stay and to ask questions and, yeah, start partnering together. Thank you all for coming tonight. We'll keep chatting. Oh, question? Yeah. Yeah, we can, yes, they'll keep you up to date. That's a good question, Lyle. Tim's dad. yes, so I think as you become partners with them, as the year comes towards the end, they'll start sending out their prayer updates so that we can be informed and praying for them, and part of that can, yeah, definitely be the financial update. Yeah, good question, Lyle. Thanks, mate. All right, we'll keep chatting with each other, but keep our distance.